this morning as you kind of get settled in. We'll start the service in just a few moments, but let me just share a few words with you of announcement. I hope you had a wonderful Thanksgiving day and a Thanksgiving weekend. It's great to be here together today. I know some families, their Thanksgiving celebration was disrupted a little bit when the CDC says you can only have 10 people. That really hurt people, but some people got very creative and figured it out because CDC said you could have 30 for a funeral. So some people celebrated, had a funeral for their pet turkey on Thanksgiving Day. So whatever you have to do to be creative, I suppose. But it is good to see you here today. Well, this is now marks the official Christmas season. It's wonderful to see all these Christmas decorations up, and I want to thank Lauren Smith and all the folks that were involved with doing this decoration. A lot of our youth were involved, and they did a marvelous job here, and I'm thankful for that. God bless them. Amen. Well, next Saturday and Sunday, we will have our Christmas musical, and it's our Jesus story. You don't want to miss it. It's going to be excellent. We still have some tickets available for Saturday night. We have more for Sunday night, and we want you to come. We hope that you'll make your plans to come. Now, you need to pass the word. We're also going to be live streaming both events, Saturday night at 6 and Sunday night at 6. It'll be live streamed. You'll just go to our website. There'll be a banner there about the Christmas musical, and you would click on that. And then you would see the live streaming there, where you would click on it to see it. If you're not able to come, and you can pass that word, because anybody around the world could watch our Christmas musical. So that'll happen on December the 5th and 6th. And if you need tickets, come by the Welcome Center after this service, and we'll provide you with tickets. And then you need to mark your calendar for Christmas Eve, December the 24th. We will have a candlelight service. We'll have two services, one at 4 and one at 6. And, of course, that is something you really want to experience in person. But, again, we will be live streaming both of those, 4 and 6. Will be live streamed also. So we were making that available to you those ways. So please note that. And then on Sunday, December the 27th, that'll be the last Sunday of this year, the pastor always likes to close the year out with the Lord's Supper. He originally was scheduled it for today, and then he realized there was probably more people out of place today, and he really wanted to do it at the end of the year, so we moved it. You may have seen it several weeks ago, thinking, I don't remember this date, but December the 27th, it'll be the last Sunday of December, and we'll do it in 9:30 service and 11 o'clock service. Remember, folks, we take care of this. It's a self-contained dispenser that you will pick up as you come in. We don't pass the elements around. So, again, it's perfectly safe, and we encourage you to participate in that, make plans for that day to close the year out. The Women's Ministry Luncheon, Sunday, January the 24th. Ladies, you need to mark this on your calendar. This will be a great event. I hope that you will bring your friends. It's a good opportunity to invite your friends to come to church with you on that Sunday, and then stay over for the luncheon that will be at 1 p.m. over in our Family Ministry Center. Now, husbands and the rest of the family, you can go somewhere, take the family out to eat someplace. This will just be for the ladies, okay? No men invited, I'm sorry. And then just want to mention last week in our food drive, we had a tremendous time last week. We distributed almost 1,300 boxes of food. We had over 300 cars came through. Many of you were here to help with that. We'd also had mentioned that on December the 12th, there'd be another food drive. Well, unfortunately, that has been canceled. The government says that they have run out of funds for the food, and there will not be any more this year. Hopefully, maybe something after the first of the year, but that drive on December the 12th has been canceled. So just want you to be aware of that. Well, if you're visiting with us today, you're a special guest. We're so glad you chose to be with us today. And in the pew in front of you, if you'll look, there's a card like this. And we'd like to ask you to take that, if you will, and fill that out. And then at the end of the service, when you exit, as you go out the doors, there'll be ushers at the door, and they'll be taking up the offering, but that'll be your offering. You just drop that card in the offering plate, and we'd love to have a record of your visit with us. We're so grateful that you're here today, and we'd love to know you were here. We'd love to pray for you. Now today, our pastor is still away. He'll be traveling actually today. So you be in prayer for him as he travels home. But today, our own Scott Humpston, our family and connections pastor, will be bringing the message this morning. And I think you'll be, it's a great message. I already heard it once this morning. And you see the notes there in your bulletin that you can follow along. So I think you will be encouraged with this word today. Well, thank you again for being here. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin our service. Father, Lord, we just praise you and worship you, and we commit this service now that the name of Christ would be lifted up. In his precious name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Would you stand with us as we sing?
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who shakes?
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing God. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. Bear my cross.
me. Father, these next few moments, would you just give us ears to hear and minds to comprehend? Thank you for blessing us this morning in song. In your name, all God's people said, amen. Thank you, praise team. Give them a hand, would you please? That was really great. Oh my goodness, I got to hear it twice because I was here the first service. So if you want to hear it twice, just come twice. You can do that. That was really good. That was worth hearing twice, wasn't it? That was great. Yeah, that was awesome. Beautiful. Hey, I just encourage you, if you don't have a ticket already for this weekend's Christmas performance, obviously we're, you know, no, can't fit as many people in here as we want to fit, but boy, that's just what you heard there is going to be, it's going to be awesome this weekend. I'm so excited about it. Well, welcome today. My name is Scott. Some of you know me. I've met many of you. I'm the new guy, so to speak. I've been, my family and I have been attending here for quite a while, but I'm the family and connections pastor. So right before I walked in here, I was on Facebook watching the video and the live stream, checking that out. And if you are live streaming with us today, thank you. It's a little slow at the moment, but I think it's going to be fixed, I hope. We've been dealing a lot, trying to get things better all the time. If you don't know my background, oh, I got to say this real quick before I forget, because this is part of my deal here. This is a big postcard. You see this big postcard? The top of it says, looking for something good for your kids, and it has some info about what we do on Wednesday nights and Sundays for kids and youth. We've been targeting neighborhoods here, neighborhoods with families. You can do that now. It's an amazing world we live in. We can pick what house has how many kids. Isn't that crazy? Yeah. And so we mail these to homes. We've been doing that. We've mailed out a few hundred already. But guess what? I ordered 2,500 of these. We're going to mail them all, but I need you to take some. And what I want you to do is keep them in your car, okay? Keep them in your car, in your glove compartment, on the front seat. If you got a little net on the back of the car, behind your driver's seat, that's where I keep mine. And if you're driving your neighborhood or you're out for a walk and you see a family with kids, I want you to stop. And I want you to, don't stop in the middle of the street. But if you see them, I want you to give them a card. I walk down the street. We have a new family moving in our neighborhood. Got two young boys, actually, and a little baby girl. I found out when I was talking to them. But and give somebody a card, right? Just give them a card for me. Would you do that? All right? Do that so I can keep my job, okay? I'd appreciate it. So, no, if you would do that, it would be great because we want to see more people come back as we open more and more, and we are gathering safely with the kids as well. So if you knew what I did before I joined this awesome church as staff, I was a traveling evangelist, some people call it itinerant evangelist, and I used magic tricks and comedy to engage with people. And the last time I spoke a couple of months ago, I did a trick, not doing one today, sorry, but I do have a couple jokes. That was not as good as the first service reaction. So this may go south really quick, all right? That's all I'm saying. I got a couple Thanksgiving jokes. Why did the turkey cross the road twice? Sylvia, do you know? To get on the other side? Nope. He crossed the road twice to prove he wasn't chicken. Stay with me. Stay with me. Now, Dale guessed this in the first service. You might have heard this one before. This is a good one. If April showers bring Mayflowers, what do Mayflowers bring? Pilgrims. Who got it? Who said that? All right, you win the prize. Pilgrims. All right. Now, honestly, at Thanksgiving, my family said, stop telling Thanksgiving jokes. Stop telling Thanksgiving jokes. And I said, I can't quit cold turkey. Some of you will get that on the way home. Now, I heard Jimmy Fallon say, as we were preparing for Thanksgiving, a new survey found, this is so fun, new survey found that 80% of men claim they help cook Thanksgiving dinner. Yeah, which makes sense when you hear they consider saying the words, that smells good, to be helping. I help too. That smells good. No, and honestly, Miss Sylvia, this has been a rough year, right? It has been a rough year. This is the first year that at our Thanksgiving, the turkey volunteered. Just said, I'm done with this. So there you go. Good. Well, listen, let's go from the silly to the scripture. If you have your Bible, would you get it, please? And if you're able to stand, I would love for you to stand as we honor God's word with the book of Psalms today. If you turn to the book of Psalms, and it's Psalm 97, and it's a short psalm. We're going to read the whole thing, okay? And Psalm 97, let's read God's word this morning. The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the multitude of isles be glad. Clouds and darkness surround him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. A fire goes before him and burns up his enemies round about. His lightnings light the world. The earth sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax at the presence of the Lord. At the presence of the Lord, the whole earth. The heavens declare his righteousness, and the peoples see his glory. Let all be put to shame who serve carved images, who boast of idols. Worship him, all you gods. Zion hears and it is glad, and the daughters of Judah rejoice because of your judgments, O Lord. For you, Lord, are most high above all the earth. You are exalted far above all gods. You who love the Lord hate evil. He preserves the souls of his saints. He delivers them out of the hand of the wicked. Light is sown for the righteous, and gladness for the upright in heart. Rejoice in the Lord, you righteous, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holy name. Let's pray. Father, this morning again, would you allow me to hide behind your cross and your word go forth? Give us ears to hear, minds to comprehend. Help us to leave this place changed. In your name, all God's people said, amen. As you are seated, if you get out your notes, I have some notes for you in the bulletin today, and I would love for you to follow along and fill in the blanks, if you would, so to speak, because we're going to be talking about Thanksgiving. As I was preparing week before last, to deliver this message, I thought, that may be a Thanksgiving message, right? After Thanksgiving. But I understand that Thanksgiving is not an easy holiday for a lot of people. Anybody in pain has a hard time being grateful. Certainly. How can you be thankful at Thanksgiving if a doctor has just told you it's cancer, right? How can you be thankful at Thanksgiving if the person you love the most just walked in and said, I don't love you anymore, I'm leaving? How can you be thankful when you have a chronic illness that just isn't getting any better? How can you be thankful this Thanksgiving, right, when you've been laid off and you've gone on your 14th job interview and you've been turned down for all of them? How can you be thankful when your dream has collapsed? Or the economic tsunami that many of us have experienced has wiped out everything you've earned in your lifetime? How can you be thankful when a loved one, someone that you love and care for, takes their own life? How can you be thankful in the middle of a worldwide pandemic? 2020 has been a horrible year for many, many people in this world. You are not alone if it is for you. How am I supposed to be thankful in the midst of this? Yet the Bible tells us always to be thankful. In the first verse on your outline, you'll see 1 Thessalonians 5:18. It'll be on the screen behind me as well. It says this: give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. You want to know what God's will is for your life? So many people go through life wondering what God's will is. Well, listen, part of God's will is that you give thanks in all circumstances. Now, the key, I believe, to this verse is that little word, but important, in, I-N. I'm grateful it doesn't say give thanks for all circumstances. It says give thanks in all circumstances. God doesn't expect you to be grateful for everything in your life, because there is a lot of bad in your life. There's a lot of bad, there's a lot of evil, there's a lot of sin in this broken world. it would be stupid to be grateful for sin and the suffering it causes. I'm not grateful when somebody gets leukemia or lupus. I'm not grateful when a child is abused. I'm not grateful when there are wars. And I am not grateful when there is racial profiling and people are prejudiced and bigoted against because of their race. And I'm not grateful when there is injustice in the world. In fact, the Bible says there are some things that you ought to get mad about, that you ought to get angry over. Anger is often an evidence of love. If somebody hurts my kids, I get angry. That's an evidence of my love for them, my care for them. God gets angry when he sees evil in the world. So the Bible doesn't say, be thankful for everything. That would make God a tyrant. But the Bible says, in everything, give thanks. Why? Because even in the darkest times, even in the worst periods of desperation, even when my life is totally falling apart, there's always some good things that I can thank God for. No matter how good things are in your life, there are some bad things you need to be working on. And no matter how bad things are in your life, there are some good things and some blessings you can be grateful for. So how can I be grateful when I don't feel like it? How can I be thankful even in bad times? I don't know what you're going through right now as we come out of this Thanksgiving holiday and moving into the Christmas season. But I do know that there are five things that you can always be grateful for. And by the way, the Bible tells us there are four ways that we can express thanks to God. By singing, we've done that today. By praying, we've done a little bit of that. We're going to do more in a minute. By giving, you can do that on your way out. And by remembering, we're going to do that in a little bit. In everything, in all things, in all circumstances, it says give thanks. This is God's will for your life in Christ Jesus. So what are the things I can always be thankful for? What are the things I can always thank God for? Well, the first one is up on the screen. The Bible says I can always be thankful for the grace that God shows me. I can be thankful for the grace that God shows me. What is grace? Grace is when God gives me what I need, not what I deserve. Grace is when God gives me what I don't deserve. Everything in your life is a gift of God's grace. The air you're breathing right now is a gift of God's grace. The next beat of your heart is a gift of God's grace. The Bible says that every good and perfect gift, everything in your life you owe to God, even your own life. He gave you your mind, he gave you your sight, your hearing, gave you your voice. Everything in your life is a gift of God, so it's all by God's grace. Now the Bible says in Ephesians 2:8, you'll see there in your notes, you have been saved by grace through faith. Some translations say believing, right? Faith equals believing, right? You have been saved by grace through faith or believing. You did not save yourselves, it says. It was a gift from God. I can't earn my way to heaven. I can't work my way to heaven. I can't buy my way to heaven. I can't bargain my way into heaven. It's just flat out a gift of God's grace. Salvation is a gift that you receive. The only thing you have to do is believe. You have to believe that Jesus Christ came and died for your sins. That's it. You didn't do anything. It was all done by Jesus. On the cross, he cried out, "It is finished," right? It is finished. I paid for your salvation. It is a gift. Now, most of our children right now are over in other life groups. We got a bunch of kids over there right now. And I know there's a couple kids here. I know Joe's up there, and who else is up there? I saw somebody else up there earlier. So I got a deal for you. It's up to you. I need a kid. The first kid to come down here and take this from me gets $5. I got $5. It's the last $5 I got in my pocket. The first kid to come get it. I need a kid. We got a kid. Joe, you coming? We got another kid up that way. $5 right here. $5 right here. First kid to get it. Coming? Yes? No? They don't want to come from the balcony? All right. First kid. Come on. Come on. You can come. Come on. You can do it. No kids. Come on. Come on. I'll meet you halfway. What's your name? Kathy. How old are you, Kathy? No, I'm teasing. Kathy. You're the kid today. You get $5, all right? It's on me, okay, all right? So no, you keep it. You keep it. Right. Hey, take me out to lunch. Okay. $5. McDonald's. Dollar menu. Hey, Kathy, let me ask you something. Did that do you any good before you took it? The $5 didn't do you any good, did it? You got to use it, right? You got to claim it. Once Kathy took that for herself, you should have seen little the first service, little Declan. He ran fast, man. He was up here. He snatched that $5 out of my hand. And that's all right, right? He ran fast to get it. And some people think there's a trick to it. No, but guess what? It didn't do him. It doesn't do Kathy. It doesn't do you any good until you claim it for yourself. And the moment that you claim it, it is yours. Kathy, you can go buy a latte. You know what latte means in Spanish? $5 cup of coffee is what it means. It's a Spanish word. I think. I'm not sure. I might have to check that. Seriously, listen to what it says in Psalms 103. David gives us a list of the gifts of God's grace. These are things we can be thankful for. He says, I will not forget the glorious things God does for me. In other words, the gracious gifts of God. He forgives all my sins by grace. He heals me by grace. He ransoms me from hell by grace. He surrounds me with his love. He fills my life with good things by his grace. He is merciful and tender toward those who don't deserve it. That means me. He is slow to get angry. He never bears a grudge. I like that one. He has not punished us as we deserve for our sins. The grace I can be thankful for that God shows to me. The second thing I can always be thankful for are the plans that God has for me. So the grace that he shows to me and the plans he has for me, because God has good plans for your life. Now, it's very obvious to all of us in this room right now that life is not always good. A lot of things in life happen are bad. They're terrible, they're painful, they're difficult. Life is tough. Life is not all sunshines and lollipops, roses and rainbows. Yet, although life is not always good, God is always good. And God's plan for your life is always good. You say, not everything that happens in my life feels good. Not everything that happens in your life did God plan. Don't blame God for your mistakes. And don't blame God for your choices. When we say that God has a plan for your life, that doesn't mean you're in it. You could be out of God's plan for your entire life. You have to choose to be in God's plan for your life. God says, there are many ways that seem right unto a man, but the ends are death. There is one road, one narrow way. You've got to choose God's plan. The Bible says in Jeremiah 29:11, a very familiar verse for many of us, I have good plans for you, says the Lord. Circle the word good in your notes, would you please? Circle the word good there. I have good plans for you, says the Lord. I don't plan to hurt you. I plan to give you a hope. To give you hope and a good future. You see, some people believe they worship the God who causes all their suffering. No, I worship a God who bears all my suffering. Isaiah 56, it says this, he was bruised for our transgressions. He was wounded for our iniquities. The chastisement for our sins was laid on him. Jesus Christ on the cross took my suffering, took my death. We have a God who doesn't watch our suffering callously. We have a God who suffers with us. And not only that takes our suffering on himself, he dies in our place. That's the plan of God. As I said, God doesn't plan the sins, either the ones you do or the ones other people do, to hurt you. And you get hurt innocently because of other people's sins, other people's choices. We all have experienced that to one degree or another. God doesn't plan those things, but listen to this. God's plan says his plan is bigger than those things. And since God already knows every stupid mistake I'm going to make and you're going to make in life, he goes, I can fit that into the plan. God already knows how other people are going to hurt us, how they're going to sin against you. And God goes, that's not good, but I can fit that into the plan. I can use that, and I can use that, and I can use that, and I can use that. That's something we can be grateful for. Let me compare our life for just a moment to that of a cruise line, right? A cruise trip. We're not going in cruising right now. Someday that'll be open again. Some of you enjoy cruises very much, and that even has affected people in our church that work for the cruise lines. But let's say that we get on a cruise, you and me, and we're going to go from Miami, we're going to go big cruise, all the way to Tokyo. And the cruise ship is headed to Tokyo. But while we're on that cruise ship, like your life, you have a lot of free choices. You have free will on that boat. It's just not completely free. You have, I guess, what I would call limited free will, right? For instance, on that cruise line, you could eat all 7 buffets. I wouldn't advise it, but you could do it. You could stay up for the midnight buffet, like March of the Penguins. You could go dancing, if that was your pleasure. You could sleep the whole time. There are a lot of things you could do on that cruise. But no matter what you do on that ship, it's going to Tokyo, and nothing's going to change it. It's the captain's job to get you to Tokyo. It's not your job. God has a plan for your life. And once you put your hand in Christ's hand, he says, I'm going to get you to heaven. Whether you realize it or not, it's not in your hands anymore. There are times you may want to let go of God's hand, but he's not going to let go of yours, because you put your hand in his by putting your faith in Christ. Like the captain's job is getting us to Tokyo, it's God's job to get us to heaven. It doesn't depend on you. Can you be grateful for that? I can. Because it doesn't depend on me to keep myself saved, thank goodness. If I work to earn my salvation, then anytime I stop working, my salvation would stop working. But I don't earn my salvation. It is the gift of God, gift of God's grace. So I put my hand in his, and I accept it through Christ. Then he's going to hold on for the rest of the cruise. So God says, I'm going to use it all. And sometimes we doubt God's plan. When tragedy strikes, when you hit the skids, when your life falls apart, when everything goes wrong, the typical thing we want to do is look for an explanation. Why? That's dumb. Because listen, explanations never, ever comfort. They don't. They don't really help at all. If someone you love were to die tomorrow, and you were to know the exact reason, that would not make it any less sorrowful. It would not make it any less painful. So don't waste time trying to figure out the why. First of all, my brain personally isn't big enough to understand all that happens in the world, and probably neither is yours. It's like an ant trying to understand the internet. There are a lot of things in your life that you're just not going to know why they happen until you get to heaven. Then it's all going to make sense, and you'll see it. What you need when you're going through a tough time is not an explanation. What you need is the presence of God. But one of the reasons I can always be thankful, even in the midst of my darkest days, is the promise of Romans 8:28. It's in your notes there. We know that in all things, not some, all things God works. We know that in all things God works for the good. It doesn't say everything is good. Listen, there's a lot of bad in the world. We know that. Even in the bad, God works for the good of those who love him. In other words, who give him the pieces and have been called according to his purpose. So I know that no matter what I go through, if I will give those pieces to God, God's going to bring good out of it. He loves to turn crucifixions into resurrections. He loves to turn crucifixions into resurrections and then bless the whole world by it. Have you ever thought about how God might want to bless the world through your pain? I can be thankful to God because I know I'm always thankful for the grace God shows me, and I'm always thankful for the plans God has for me. And the third on your outline, you can fill in there, it's on the screen. I'm always thankful no matter what happens in my life for God's promise to never leave me. God's promise to never leave me. I want you to think about this for just a second, this truth. There is not a moment in your life that God isn't with you. There's not a moment in your life that God isn't with you. For some of us, that doesn't initially sound very good because it's actually a scare tactic of parents worldwide. Right? We say that to our children. God's with you. He has his eye on you. He's watching you. But listen, that's actually a powerful, powerful truth. Look at what God says in Hebrews 13:5 there in your outline. God says this, I will never leave you. I will never abandon you. Some translations say forsake. I will never abandon you, he says. God will never leave us. He will never abandon us. But here's the wonderful part of that promise. The scripture isn't there to coerce us into staying out of trouble. It's actually there to comfort us in times of trouble. there's actually a comfort in times of trouble. What a difference between those two things, right? There's not a moment in your life, not a situation you find yourself in, there's not a depth of experience, a sense of loss or loneliness we could ever travel alone. God's always with us. He never leaves us. And guess what? There's no fine print. There's no little asterisk by that. It's not like those drug commercials we see on television. It says this is what it's going to help you feel better about, but the side effects are like this long. And like, I don't want to take that. Right? There's no fine print. God will be with us, and he will never leave us, period. Look at this verse there on your notes in Isaiah 43:2. It says this, when you go through deep waters, I will be with you. When you pass through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through fire, you will not be burned up. It will not consume you. So I'm not sure what deep waters you have gone through this year. I'm not sure what fires you felt have consumed you. My hunch is that a room this size, there's been a lot of loss. A lot of abandonment. Maybe there's a husband or a wife or a mother or a father or a coworker or a friend that's walked out on you and you felt abandoned, you felt alone. Maybe you've just gone through stuff as a family where you were like, God, are you really with us now in all of this? Are we walking through this situation by ourselves? The answer is a resounding no. God promises he will never leave us. So I'm not sure what has you worried this Thanksgiving season. And as we move into the Christmas Advent, the expectation of waiting, right? But one of the best ways for us to be thankful is to recognize God's promise that he'll never leave us. That's good news. And actually, when we pray a prayer of thanksgiving to God for his faithfulness, that's a powerful way we can have faith in times we're going through a crisis, we're going through a loss, is to pray in the midst of that time a prayer of thanksgiving. So that's what I'd like to do. I'd like to pray a prayer of thanks to God this morning, and I'd like you to do that as well. Here's what I want you to do. If you have a need of God today, you have a spot in your life where you'd say, if I'm honest, God, I feel like you're not with me on this one. I feel like you've abandoned me here in this situation. That's what I want you to pray into today. So would you bow your heads with me? And just where you are, it's between you and God. Not out loud, but if there is a specific spot in your life right now that you feel like, God, man, you're not with me here, I want you to invite him into that space right now and give that to him. He knows what it is anyway, but give it to him. He can handle it. Heavenly Father, as we reflect on this Thanksgiving season. Father, there's times, God, if we're honest with ourselves right now, there are times, Father, and places in our life right now, it's tough. It's tough to say thanks. Because, God, we feel alone. Father, I'm not sure what those moments are and what those areas are for my friends this morning. But, God, I would pray that they would sense your powerful presence in their lives right now. God, if they feel alone in a relationship, they feel alone because of their plans for life have begun to fall apart and unravel. Father, whatever it is in our life, whatever our need is, this moment I pray that right now we would sense your direction, your powerful, loving, never-wavering presence in our lives. In your name, I pray. Amen. Look at your verse in your outline in Philippians 4:6. Just a reminder of the importance of prayer in our lives as we give thanks. It says this, don't be anxious or worried about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Always making your requests known to God with thanksgiving. Do me a favor, circle the word thanksgiving there in your outline. That's the second way we express our thanksgiving to God. The first by singing, the second by praying. So no matter what happens in my life, I can always thank God for the grace God shows me, for the plan God has for me, and for the promise that he'll never leave me. The fourth, in our fill in the blank this morning there, you can put this, I can always be thankful for the changes God is making in me. I can always be thankful for the changes God is making in me. Here's the good news. No matter what I go through, God will use it to change me for the better. That's part of Romans 8:28. He's working inside me. He's not just with me. He's actually in me. He's inside of me making changes. Romans 5, 3 and 4 says this: we can have joy even in our troubles because we know that these troubles produce endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. So why does that make me joyful? Why is it that God building character in my life is such an important thing? Because it's the only thing you're taking with you to heaven is you, your character, who you are. You're not taking your career. You're not taking your reputation. You're not taking your money. You're not taking your hobbies. You're not taking your clothes, your china, or your car. But you are taking your character, who you are. The only thing that is going to heaven is you. You as a spiritual being. God says this is so important. I will use everything, even the pain in your life, to build your character, to make you more patient, more loving, more secure. Love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, meekness, self-control. These are the things God wants to build in your life. Here's the good news. While circumstances may be working against you, and while other people may be working against you, the good news that you can be thankful for is this: God is working in you. Look at the next verse in your outline, Philippians 2:13. For God is working in you, giving you the desire to obey him and the power to do what pleases him. 2 Corinthians 3 says this: as the Spirit of the Lord works within us, I can be grateful for that, we become more and more like him. I can be grateful for that. God knows that even the bad stuff that happens in my life this year, he'll use it to make me more like Jesus. I can be thankful in that. True confession: I'm not all I should be. I am not all I should be. But thank God he's changing me. If you don't like me right now, hang on. I'm getting better. I'm getting better. And by the grace of God, I can say these three things, and you can say these three things too. By the grace of God, I'm not what I used to be. By the grace of God, I am what I am. And by the grace of God, I'm not what I'm going to be, because he's working in me. During that time when he's working on us and that pain comes into our lives, we often feel weak and we often feel defeated. That's okay. That's when God's strength shows up the best. 2 Corinthians 12:9 says this: but God said to me, my grace is all you need. When you are weak, my power is made perfect in you. So, Paul says, I'm happy to brag about my weaknesses. Then Christ's power can live in me. Have you ever thanked God for this? The fact that while other people and circumstances are working against you, that God is working in you, for you, to make you a better man, to make you a better woman, a young person? Let's stop and thank God for that. One of the ways that God does this is by causing us to remember the things that he's taken us through. The Bible said in the Psalms 50:23, it says this: giving thanks is a sacrifice that truly honors me. Did you know that? The Bible says when you pause to remember what God has done in your life, then it's like a sacrifice to God. He says, it honors me when you stop and say thank you. Have you done that for what he's done in your life this year? In spite of all the bad things? Let's look at another verse. It's in your outline. It's one we read this morning from Psalms 97, verse 12. Remember what your holy God has done for you and give thanks to him. That's a command. We're commanded to remember. The third way to give thanks during the Thanksgiving season is to remember. The Bible says, honor the Lord and worship him. Remember all of the great things he's done for you. So maybe it was a worship experience you remember from years ago, and it was really moving to you, and you took a major life turn after that worship experience. Or maybe it was a story or a lesson that you had in your life group. Or maybe they showed up and supported you. Or maybe you had a good time of fellowship with your life group, as my life group did last night. The David and Toby Parker's house. Thank you, David and Toby, for that. It was a delightful night. Maybe you had a life-changing experience on a missions trip that you remember. Or maybe you had a friend that's come to Christ. Or maybe you've been involved in one of the many ministries at First Mount Dora to our community in the last few months. Even in spite of the mess that we're in, we've been able to do. Maybe something happened during that time. I'd like to hear about it. Maybe it was a lesson learned or a personal change or personal growth or a decision that you made or giving a testimony or giving in faith. So I'm going to ask Lynn to come, if you would. Thank you, Lynn. And I want you to take just a moment on that outline that you've got, and I want you to write down some words, just one or two, maybe five or six, maybe even a small paragraph of something you're thankful to God for. Being a part, perhaps, of this church family. Maybe it was in an experience. I want you to take just a moment, and don't look at me. Look in you, and write down something that you're thankful to God for. Do that now as she plays. You're at home watching this on our live stream, you can do that at home as well. So take just a moment. You're in your Bible or your notes. Write down something you're thankful for. Be thankful and remember. That's what writing that down does. Remember. It allows us to remember. I remember just a few weeks ago, as I began to bring children back to our church, as we began to do that, and we had to figure out what to do, and so we created this program on Wednesday nights called The Sweet Life, and it was Taste and See That the Lord is Good. And my ministry for all of these years has been pretty much me. And so in my ego-centered male mind, I thought on Wednesday night, it'd just be me. And so the first Wednesday night, 25 kids show up, and all of a sudden I have helpers. I didn't even ask these ladies to help. I had April and my wife Debbie and Barbara and Linda is here, and had all of these helpers, and I've left out a couple. Scott helped me, and all these people, they just showed up. I didn't even ask them. A penny as well. I didn't even ask for help, and they just showed up. I'm so thankful for that, because I would have fallen flat on my face. Mike, I couldn't have done it myself. And these ladies showed up, and they've been there every Wednesday night helping me. And our last Wednesday night, by the way, we ended up with 36 kids, which is great. Remember, we're kind of starting over. We're rebuilding, right? So I was thankful for that. And God, you know what? God was looking out for me in that moment, right? For sure, I'm thankful. I can be thankful for so much, and you can too if we take time to remember. The fifth thing that you can be thankful to God about or for is this: the home that He has prepared for me. The home He has prepared for you and me. I'm talking about heaven. I can always be thankful no matter what I'm going through, no matter what pain and experience, that the pain is not going to last, that God has prepared a home for me in heaven. I'm grateful that this life is not all there is. If this life were all that there is, I would be in ultimate despair. And honestly, if you are here this morning and you're not a Christ follower, I don't know how you make it. I really don't. I hope you can hear my heart in that. I would be in ultimate despair if this life were all there is. You know, in The Sweet Life, I told you a moment ago, we had done on Wednesday nights, and by the way, we're doing something new for Advent, and then we'll be doing something new in January, but we talked about heaven one night. We I hit him with some pretty heavy stuff because I want him to grow. But one of the weeks we talked about heaven, and this was the big idea. If you don't know this, every week they had a little slip of paper, mom and dad, and they took it home with them, and they would remember the big idea. And the big idea that week was: the hope of heaven gives me comfort and strength. And I'm so proud that in the first service, as I said that, a little kid over this way finished the saying for me. The hope of heaven gives me comfort and strength. I'm grateful that there is more to life than here and now. I am grateful that this mess is not the end of the story. One day God is going to right the wrongs, and I see a lot of wrong in the world. One day justice will be served. This is not the end of the story. John 14 says this. Jesus says, I am going there. He's talking about heaven. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. What an incredible promise. Circle the phrase there in your notes. Circle the phrase, prepare a place for you. Do that. Circle that. Prepare a place for you. The Bible calls the church the bride of Christ. He's preparing a place for his bride, those who've put their faith in him. You want to know how long God has been preparing heaven for you? Look at the next verse there on your outline, Matthew 25, 34. Then the king will say, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. That's a long time. He's been preparing heaven, Kathy, for you, for me, for all of us, since the creation of the world. What is heaven going to be like? The Bible says, eye has not seen nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the wonderful things God has prepared for those who love him. You can't imagine it. Most people have such a poor idea of heaven. Who'd want to go there, they think. Media sometimes portrays heaven as completely colorless. Are you kidding me? Who do you think created color? It's not going to be all white. You're not going to sit in a robe with angel's wings playing a harp on a cloud. Think about this for a moment. There are a lot of wonderful and beautiful things on this planet, and God created each of them. You think about the sunrises and sunsets, even here in this beautiful Florida where we live, the beautiful beach landscapes, even Bora Bora and the tall redwood forests, and the beauty of the flowers and the colors. The earth is broken, and it's still an amazing place. This place is marred by sin. That's why nothing works exactly right, yet it is still an amazing place, right? Think about what a place with no sin and no suffering and no sorrow and no destruction would be like. We can't even imagine that. I know we can't. It says we can't. God has been preparing it since the foundation of the earth. No matter what I go through, I know it's not going to last. I know that this is not the end of the story. I know that God has prepared a home for me in heaven forever. What is heaven going to be like? I'll read it again. It says, eye has not seen nor ear heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the wonderful things that God has prepared for those who love him. We know that in heaven we'll be reunited with loved ones. I have a father in heaven. I have friends in heaven. I have an unborn child in heaven. I will be reunited with those who love the Lord and who are there. I know that we will be released from all pain, that in heaven there will be no more broken minds from mental illness, no more broken bodies that don't work right, there'll be no more broken dreams, no more broken relationships, no more broken communication, no more broken hearts, no more broken promises. We'll be released. The Bible says this in 1 Peter 1. God has reserved for his children. By the way, let me stop right there and say this. God put that reservation in for you a long time ago. God has reserved your place in heaven. He has reserved for his children the priceless gift of eternal life, it says. Is everybody going to heaven? Absolutely not. The Bible says only his children are going to be in heaven. Is everybody a child of God? No. Everybody's created by God, and everybody is loved by God. God has never made a person he doesn't want in heaven. God has never made a person he doesn't have a plan for their life. But you don't become a child of God until you choose to join his family. God's not going to try to force you to love him. Love is only love if I have the choice. A lot of people say, forget you, God. I don't need a savior. I don't need God. I'm God. I'm going to be my own God. I can get to heaven on my own. You can't, you won't, because you're not perfect, and neither am I. The height of ultimate arrogance is to say, I get to decide how to go to God's house. Really? You can't earn it. You can't deserve it. You can't work for it. You can't be good enough. You can't be religious enough. The only way you're getting to heaven, friend, is by grace. By God forgiving you and you saying to God, I need your forgiveness. I need your grace. I need you to save me. That's why Jesus came. For unto you is born a Savior. If you didn't need a Savior, God wouldn't have sent one. There's no way you're getting into heaven on your own. You have to go the only way you get in, and that's through the grace of God. To miss heaven, you'd almost have to do the impossible. You have to reject the love of God out of pride. I don't need forgiveness. I don't need a Savior. Listen to what it says. God has reserved for his children the priceless gift of eternal life. It is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. And God in his mighty power will make sure. Circle the word make sure there in the scripture. Circle that word make sure. And God in his mighty power will make sure that you get there safely. It is the job of the captain of that cruise to make sure you get there safely. It's not your job. It's not my job to make sure I get to heaven. It's God's job. Thank goodness for that. Once I put my hand in his, he's not letting go. He will make sure that you get there safely. I can be grateful, even in pain, because I know I'm going to heaven. I'm getting there by God's grace because I put my trust in Jesus, what Jesus did for me. That's why I can be thankful this Thanksgiving season. 2 Corinthians 4 says this, we often suffer, but we're never crushed. Even when we don't know what to do, we never give up. In times of trouble, God is with us. And when we are knocked down, we get up again. We know that God raised the Lord Jesus back to life. And just as he raised Jesus, he will also raise us back to life and will bring us into his presence together so we don't focus on the troubles we see right now. Instead, we look forward to what we don't see yet. For the troubles we see now are temporary, but the joys to come will last forever. If you have not settled this issue in your life, whether you're here with us or watching, you need to do so right now. Because you're not guaranteed tomorrow. You're not guaranteed next week, next year. If you were to die this evening, and Jesus were to say to you, why should I let you in my heaven? What would you say? Do you know the right answer? Oh, I was trying to be a good person. I had done more good than bad. Sorry, wrong answer. You need to accept the grace and the forgiveness of God in your life, and you need to turn your life over to the God who made you. If you haven't settled that issue, you can do that right now. In a moment, I'm going to lead a prayer. And I want you to pray it, if that is your desire this morning. It's the most important words you'll ever say in your life. It determines eternal destiny. It is the height of arrogance to think you can come to God on your own terms. God has done everything for you. You don't have to do anything. You just receive it by faith. So Lynn, if you would come, would you bow your heads with me? As we pray this morning, if it is your desire, if you've never prayed a prayer and asked Christ into your heart, you can do that. You can say your own words where you are, but if you don't know what to say, you say, Scott, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. I'll lead you in this prayer. Let's pray together. Dear God, first I want to thank you for loving me. Everything I have is a gift from you, Father. And I don't express that gratitude very often. I thank you that you have a good plan for my life. I thank you that you've promised to never leave me. I thank you that when people are working against me, you want to work in me. I thank you there is hope of heaven in eternity. And you're preparing a home that you want me to be a part of. Dear God, there's no way I can get to heaven on my own. I need a Savior. So, Father, I humbly ask you, Jesus, to forgive all my sins, to come into my heart at this very moment, to show me your grace, to accept me into your family. Father, I want to be your child. As best I know how, I want to learn to love you and trust you for the rest of my life. And I want you to take me safely to heaven. I pray this in your name. With our heads still bowed and our eyes closed. If you said a prayer like that this morning, in just a moment, as we sing the invitation, I want you to slip out of your seat and go right to the Welcome Center, which is in the back, right out these main doors. You'll see it. Someone will be standing out there to pray with you. We'll take you to a private room, safely distanced from you, but we're going to pray with you, give you some material you can take home with you. If there's another need in your life that you need someone to talk to about today, we can pray with you for that too. I want you to know that. Let's sing.
This is my desire.
Watching right now on Facebook or on our live stream, I want you to know something that if you'll just put in the comments a prayer request, we'd love to pray with you. We do read all of that feed as it comes in, and if you need something, just reach out to our church office so we can pray for you and give you this material. For the benediction today, I want you to think about something that you're thankful for as you leave here. I hope you wrote it down. I hope you'll take that home with you. Put it in your Bible, put it in your notebook, stick it on your fridge, make it a screensaver on your phone. So this week, as you're going through a trial or tribulation, that you can look at that and remember to be thankful. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for allowing us together this morning. Father, thank you for those that are at home right now watching. Father, we thank you for the ability to do that. Father, we thank you for those in this service right now that have remembered and have prayed, that we would leave this place renewed and thankful for what you have done for us. In your name, all God's people said, amen. Have a great week.